La 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 la. La 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 la. Sing it with me tonight. I will always give you the glory, worship you only, Lord. I will always love and adore you. There's no one before you as long. That I will always worship you. I will always, always worship you. I'll lift my hands. I'll give you glory. I'll give you honor, yeah. I'll lift my hands. Yes, I will always worship you. I will always worship you. Hallelujah.
Well, God bless you this evening. Thank you so much for tuning in. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, we just bless you and we honor you this evening. We thank you, Lord, for once again allowing us, Father, to gather around your word. And Father, we pray that as we study your word, we pray, Father, that something would be spoken, Lord, that will help us in our walk with you. We pray, Lord, for the Holy Spirit to minister to each and every heart listening to this message this evening. And Father, we pray that lives will be changed because of the teaching and the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, God bless you this evening. Thank you so much for tuning in. This month on Wednesday nights, we're doing a teaching on faith. And last Wednesday, I think we talked about faith for the impossible. Tonight, I want to talk with you about faith that pleases God. Faith that pleases God. In Hebrews chapter 11, the text says this in verse 6. It says, "But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him." The text says now, without faith, it's impossible for us to please God. And so we can glean from this particular verse that faith is important to God. Because I can say it like this, without faith, we're making God unhappy with us. Because the text says that without faith, it's impossible to please him. And so if we want to live a life of faith, a life that is pleasing to God, then our faith has to be to a level whereby God can say, okay, I'm pleased with your faith walk, if you will. God is not happy, based on this particular verse, God's not happy when he doesn't see faith. But he says that now, without faith, it is impossible to please him, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. But then he goes on in verse 7, and he gives an illustration. Verse 7, he says, "By faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith." And so he starts out in verse 6 saying that without faith we can't please him. But then he goes on and gives us an illustration. And he uses Noah. And he points out Noah as an illustration of faith that pleases him. But not just Noah only, but he has a whole litany of people in this particular chapter who had moved out in faith. And so we find this story over in Genesis chapter 6. It says, "But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord." In other words, when it says that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord, it means that God looked at Noah and said, in essence, "I'm pleased with Noah." And so we see here in Hebrews chapter 6, the chapter that has the Hall of Faith individuals in it. He starts out saying that without faith it's impossible to please him. And then he gives us the illustration and he starts out with Noah. And so he says here in Genesis 6, chapter 8, in reference to Noah, that Noah found grace in the eyes of God, which means that God looked at Noah and God was pleased with Noah. And so now you have to ask yourself, if I can't please God without faith, and God was pleased with Noah, what was it about Noah that pleased God? What was it about this individual, this person, this man of God, who God singled out and said, I'm pleased with him? Look at verse 9, Genesis chapter 6, verse 9. Watch what the text says. "These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generations, and Noah walked with God." So allow me to pull out some observations about Noah, because God said that Noah found grace with him, meaning that God was pleased with Noah. And so we want to find out, okay, what was it about Noah that pleased God? What was it about his faith that pleased God? And the first observation that we learn from Noah in verse 9 is that Noah walked with God. In other words, Noah did not follow the culture of his time. He did not follow everybody else during that time that he lived. Noah adjusted his lifestyle to line up with God. And so the text says that Noah walked with God. And so Noah was the only one at that time walking with God. He was the only one that adjusted his lifestyle to line up with God, whereby he pleased God. I am convinced that the reason that a lot of believers are not finding favor with God and not finding the direction that they're asking or believing God for is because they're not truly walking with God. They're not truly yielding themselves to the Word of God. We're living in a time that I believe really isn't no different than any other time. I mean, when you look back over history, there was sin back in the day just like there's sin now. There was stuff going on back then like it is now. We're just living in our generation of time, our dispensation of time. And we have to make a decision as individuals. Are we going to walk in line with the Word of God? Or are we going to allow ourselves to be pulled by the teachings and the flow of the culture? Or are we going to just line up with what God says and stay with God? Because this is what Noah did. He adjusted his lifestyle with Noah. Noah was the only one, in spite of what was going on in his time, that walked with God. There are times when we have to make a decision that we're going to walk alone with God. And that's what Noah did. He walked alone with God. He pleased God because he made a decision. You know what? I'm staying with God. I understand what's going on around me. I see how things are playing out before me. But I make a decision that I'm just going to stick with God. And there are times when we have to make a decision as believers that we're going to go on with God. We're going to stick with God. We can't allow ourselves to be waiting for other people to get their self together. You know, you just got to move on. I've learned, man, that when people don't want to go in the same direction that you're going in under their own power, then you just can't wait for them to get it together if you really want to move with God. You just got to go on and just pray for them and believe that, you know, they're going to turn their lives around. But this thing of waiting on people to get their lives together and hoping people get their lives together, no, if you're really serious about God, man, you could just got to focus on him and say, you know, I'm going on with Jesus. And this is what Noah did. Noah, he walked with God. He was the only one in his generation that walked with God. That's why he found favor with God, because imagine now you being the only one standing for righteousness. You have to know that he's being persecuted. You have to know that he's standing out like a sore thumb. You have to know that people are probably talking about him behind his back. Oh, you think he's holier than thou? Look at Noah. Look at him. But he withstood the persecution. He withstood the pressure of the culture. And he made a decision that he was going to adjust his life and adjust his lifestyle and stay with God. And I believe that this is really important to us as believers, that we have to make a decision that we're going to adjust our lifestyles and to stay with God. That's why he found favor with God. And so we see here the first observation about Noah is that he walked with God. Now, again, keep in mind, I'm giving you these observations because we find out over in Hebrews chapter 11, God gives Noah as one of the first illustrations of faith that pleased him. Chapter 6, verse 14, it says, make thee an ark of gopher wood. Room shall thou make in the ark, and shall pitch it within and without with pitch. Now notice what God is doing. God has given Noah instructions to build an ark. He's telling Noah, I want you to build an ark. And he says here, now he's giving him instructions. Verse 14, I'm going to read it again. He says, make thee an ark of gopher wood. Rooms shall thou make in the ark, and shall pitch it within and without with pitch. And so now God gives Noah instructions. Now, what's so powerful about this situation is that God tells Noah, I want you to build an ark. Now, understand he gives him the dimensions of the ark, how to build an ark. Now, this ark, historians say, is about the size of today, in modern day, would be about the size of 2 football fields. And so God tells Noah to build an ark the size of 2 football fields. And Noah obeys. Now, there's a lot of issues about this request that God's given Noah. But the second observation I want you to notice here is that Noah obeys God. And so the first observation is that he walked with God. And then the second observation is that he obeyed God. He tells him to build an ark. Noah obeys. But now, again, there's issues with this request because God's telling him, I want you to build an ark. But now his, one of the first issues is the fact that it's never rained before. In fact, the Bible says that the earth would be watered from beneath. That's how the earth was watered up until chapter 6. The mist in the ground watered the earth. It never rained before. And so the first issue with this request from God to Noah to build an ark is it never rained. Noah doesn't even have a clue about what rain is, but he obeyed God. And then the second issue with this request is God instructs him to build an ark of the size of 2 football fields. That's huge. But yet he obeyed. And then the third observation in reference to this request from God is the fact that he tells Noah, he says, now, once you build an ark, I want you to put 2 animals of each creation on the boat. 2 animals of every kind, God says, I want you to put on the boat. That's the third observation or issue that we have here with this request from God. And then the last observation is this. The text lets us know that it took Noah 120 years to build the ark. And so Noah didn't have this in advance. Now we have it. Now we know how long it took because we have the word of God. But Noah did not have this information in advance. The text says in verse 22 of chapter 6, thus did Noah, according to all that God commanded him, so did he. Now, Noah walked with God, stayed with God, notwithstanding his culture. The text says that he obeyed God when God instructed him to build an ark. Noah didn't have a clue about what rain was. He didn't have a clue about how long it was going to take. And he didn't have no issue with how large this particular project was going to be. Now, here's my point, because this is important. Because we see here that Noah had a faith that pleases God because he is the first person that's mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11 after God says, without faith, it is impossible to please him. And then he uses Noah as an illustration. Here's the point. Please don't miss the point. The point is this. God calls what Noah did faith. He calls it faith. When it comes to faith, here it is. Our obedience, my obedience, your obedience, must precede understanding. This is what pleased God about Noah. His obedience to God's request pleased God. Thus did Noah, according to all that God commanded him, so did he. Now, I've raised 4 children, and there was times when I would ask one of them to do something. I'm going to use Brooke, because Brooke would be the one that would most likely ask why. But I would ask Brooke, I'd tell Brooke to do something, and her response would be, why? And sometimes I would explain to her why, and then sometimes I would just say, because I said so. I just didn't feel like explaining to her why. And the reason I didn't feel like explaining to her why was because even after I would have explained why I wanted her to do a certain thing, she still wouldn't have understood why. So I just said, do it. Now, this is the same thing with God sometimes. When God gives us instructions to do something, we ought to obey and obey immediately and just follow through with what God tells us to do. Because when it comes to faith, our understanding will come after our obedience. Man, I'm telling you, this is key right here. When it comes to faith, understanding oftentimes follows obedience. Sometimes God would tell you to do something or instruct you to do something, or the Holy Spirit will impress on you to do something, and all you have is the impression or the instructions from God to do it, but you really don't understand where it's going. You really don't understand where it's leading. You just know that God said, do it, but you have no understanding. And after you do it, then you get the understanding. When I first started out in ministry as a young babe in Christ, I can remember plainly what God spoke to my heart, and he told me to buy a 14,000 square foot commercial building and start church. Now, understand, I had no church members. I had a little small thing going on at the house, but it wasn't nobody there but me and my wife and the kids. You know, I didn't really have a church. But God spoke to me, he said, I want you to buy this 14,000 square foot commercial building and start a church. And so when I started the church, I had no members, and I started out with a building. God didn't give me time to raise money or all that kind of stuff. He just said, buy the building. And at that time, I was hesitant because I really couldn't wrap my hands around, why would you want me to do this? You know, and I don't have any security in terms of any tie-paying members. But it wasn't until I went to a conference. And when I went to the conference, they had these big cameras that they swing around, and they take that filming people for television. And this camera, I guess a big old boom camera, I don't know what it was. That thing was huge. But they were swinging that thing around. They had like three or four of them. And the Holy Spirit said, look at that camera. And I got out of praise and worship, and I'm looking at the camera. So I'm like, okay, I see the camera. And the Holy Spirit said, look at the other one. I swung around, I looked at the other one, and I started looking around the room, and I noticed there was four cameras, two in the front, two in the back. And as I'm looking at these cameras, I'm like, okay, I see the cameras. And then the Holy Spirit spoke to me. And the Holy Spirit said, one of these cameras costs more than that building that you've been instructed to buy. And it just blew up in me. I got a revelation. Okay, you know what? I just need to go ahead with God and purchase this building and get some understanding later. But make a long story short, I had no money. I had no members. But I went and I talked to the gentleman, and God had already worked that thing out. He had already worked that thing out. That gentleman sold me that building. He said, listen, you just go home. You write up what you want to pay for it and how you're going to pay for it, and I'll sign it. Now notice, he said, tell me what you want to pay for it, how you want to pay for it, write it up, and I will sign it. He didn't tell me how much he wanted. He didn't tell me when he wanted the money. He told me, you tell me what you want to pay for it. You tell me how you want to pay for it, and I'll sign the contract. And I'm like, man, this is incredible. But God was showing me how, in that particular situation, how understanding always follows obedience. See, there's a lot of times when we want God to show us before we obey. And the problem with that is God is not going to come into agreement with us evaluating his will for us when he wants us to do something. God's not going to let us evaluate how he's doing things. God's not going to bring us to the table and let us negotiate or let us have a say on how he's going to play out our will in our lives. No, God is simply going to say, this is what I want you to do, so do it. And so here, God tells Noah to do something, Noah obeys, and then the obedience of, because of his obedience, he finds out later that, you know, the earth is saved and how God is doing things and how God's using him after his obedience. Now, here's the point that I'm trying to make here, and that is this. And this is what we learned from Noah and the life of Noah and his faith that pleased God. And that is, we can't figure God out. So we need to stop trying to figure God out. If you're listening to me tonight and you're in a faith battle and God has instructed you to do something, or the Holy Spirit has impressed on you to do something, and now you're sitting around trying to figure it out, you're trying to work out the ends so you can make things work. You're trying to figure out how you're going to do it and when you're going to do it and how you're going to make it work because you know God wants you to do this thing. Let me help you. You need to just go ahead and just do what God told you to do. Notice about Noah. Noah did not hesitate. He did not procrastinate. He did not try to figure out, okay, why does God want me to build this big old boat? What's rain? What you mean about rain? What you talking about, God? No, he just immediately obeyed. Because oftentimes when God speaks to our heart and tells us to do something, when we procrastinate and try to figure out what God is doing or try to help God do what God told us to do, we mess up. And that's the type of faith that does not please God. Noah had a faith that pleased God because Noah responded immediately when God spoke to his heart. Now, here's the thing. You and I cannot figure God out. Forget it. There's no sense in you and I trying to figure out God because we can't figure out God. And I have scripture to support it. Isaiah 55, verse 8, the text says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts." God is saying, listen, you and I do not have the capacity to think on a level in which God operates. Forget it. You and I do not have the capacity to operate on a level in which God operates. Forget it. The Bible says that God can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we might ask or think, which means if you can think it, it's too low for God, because God can go higher. If you can ask it, it's too low for God, because God can go higher. Because he can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. In other words, we don't even have the human capacity to be able to exhaust God in his thinking or to be able to exhaust God in his goodness. Listen, if you are a born-again Christian, listen to me tonight, then you will find that you will be in situations or you will encounter situations whereby God will ask you to do something that will not make sense. Let me say that again. If you are a Christian, if you are a born-again believer, walking with God, you will find that there will be times when God will impress on you to do something that will not make sense to your intellect. Every person in Hebrews chapter 11 will put there in Hebrews chapter 11 because they were placed in situations that did not make sense. But regardless of their situation not making sense, they proceeded to do what God told them to do. And by them going ahead and doing what God instructed them to do, it pleased God. And because their faith pleased God, they ended up in the hall of faith. Now, why? Because they walked by faith, simply because they walked by faith. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:7, "For we walk by faith, not by sight." We walk by faith, not by sight. Now, let me give you a few more things before I close this out. And this is important here. And that is, oftentimes we try to make faith a function of our minds. And faith is not a function of our minds. It's not a function of thinking. This is why when God tells you to do something, you have to remove your thinking. You have to remove wisdom, your education, your experience. You have to remove that out of the way. Because if you bring that into play, it will hinder what God told you to do or God instructed you to do. Faith is not a function of the mind. It's a function of the spirit. And it wasn't until I got that teaching that I understood, you know what, I really wasn't pleasing God with my faith, because I will oftentimes try to bring my intellect in with the faith flow of what I was trying to do with God. And it would hinder me every time. It wasn't until I understood that faith is a function of the spirit and not of the mind that allowed me, okay, you know what? Move. Just when God says do it, I just do it. Because the Bible says again over in Ephesians 3:20 that he can do abundantly above all that we can ask or think. If you just think about that right there for just a moment, that's enough to just blow your mind right there. That he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. If you could think it, God can do it better. If you can ask it, God can do better. Now, because faith is the function of the Spirit, there are four things that's very important for us to remember when we try to move out in faith with God. Let me say that again. Because faith is a function, or is a function of the Spirit, there's several things we need to remember when we're trying to operate in faith as we walk with God, if we're going to have a faith that pleases God. And the first thing is this, and I think I just touched on this slightly, and that is, when it comes to faith and a faith that pleases God, we have to come to that place where we recognize that our education, our experience, our common sense must submit to Scripture. Let me say that again. Our education, our common sense, and our experience must submit to Scripture. It must submit to the Word of God. There's no way for me as a believer to operate in faith in my intellect, with my education, with my wisdom, with my experience. Because when my education or my wisdom or my experience comes into play, it hinders my faith. This is why it's very difficult sometimes to get a intellect saved. This is why it's very difficult sometimes to get people who function on a high level of wisdom saved, because they're very practical people. They're very common sense type people, and everything 2 + 2 has to equal 4, because if 2 + 2 doesn't equal 4, then it's not right with this type of mindset. And we know, for those of us who serve God, that God does not, when he does math, God does not add. God multiplies. That's why he says, one can put 1,000 to flight, but 2, 10,000. That's how God flows. And so when it comes to faith, we cannot allow our intellect, our education, our common sense, or our experience to come into play, because it will hinder our faith. The Bible says it very clearly, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14, but the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, but they are foolish unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. The Bible says that the natural man, the man who thinks with common sense, a man who uses his intellect, he says he cannot receive the things of God or the things of the Spirit, for their foolishness unto him. You get someone with an education, common sense, experience, the natural man, trying to handle spiritual things. Spiritual things are foolishness to a natural man because they can't understand them. And so we cannot come to God with our common sense, our education, our wisdom, and our experience, and approach spiritual things and think we're going to please God. It doesn't work that way. It just doesn't work that way. When I think about intellect and common sense and trying to get something from God, I think about in the Gospels where Jesus is preaching and they're in this house, and I'm paraphrasing, Jesus is preaching, they're in the house, and there's so many people in the house that they're blocking the doorway, and he had these two guys who has a friend that's on a stretcher. And so because they can't get inside the house, the Bible says because of the press, because of the people, they can't get inside the house, his friends take him up to the roof of the house. They tear a hole inside the roof, and they lower their friend down on the mat and on the stretcher. They lower him down in the middle of the house, right where Jesus is preaching. And Jesus says, because of your faith, he's healed. Now notice, it wasn't the faith of the guy that's on the mat. It was the faith of his friends that got him healed. Jesus was like, man, because you didn't allow your intellect, because you didn't allow your reasoning ability or your experience stop you, he says, your friend's going to be healed. Here's what it is. Here's what that. This is how that plays out for you and I. But God instructs us to do something, and we do it based on faith and don't allow our reasoning ability to get in the way. God's pleased with that, because it takes faith to operate outside of the realm of the natural. It takes faith to operate outside of common sense and what you know from experience. And then the second thing is this: the response of our feelings has to submit to the Word of God. What does that mean? It means that now there's been times when God asked me to do something, and immediately a fear, which is a feeling, would grip my heart. But I did not allow that fear to hinder my faith. I just did it afraid. I would like to tell you there was times when God told me to do something, I was this great giant of faith, and I just, yeah, God said do it. Hallelujah, God said do it. I would be lying to you. There's times when God has told me to do something, and I'm trembling in my boots. Now, I didn't let you know or anybody else know. I didn't let my wife know. You know, I want my wife to think that I'm this strong spiritual giant that's over, you know, as her spiritual head. But reality, of course, she knows. Reality is, you know, there's times when God told me to do something, and I'm not certain, but I do it anyway. Because I make my fear, I make my anxiety, I make my worry, whatever emotion tries to rise up in me, I make it submit to the Word of God. I immediately overrule my fear or my emotions by reading the Word of God. Because faith is not feeling. Faith has nothing to do with how you feel. And our feelings will hinder our faith. Imagine Noah telling God, okay, you want me to build this ark, and this thing is huge. And tell me again about what this thing about rain, what were you saying about rain? Now, isn't the ground watered through the mist coming up from the ground? So what's this rain stuff about? Imagine him trying to negotiate because of his intellect and how he's feeling, thinking, oh God, that's just going to take so long. I don't have no time to be doing that. Now, remember, God didn't give Noah a time frame. It took Noah 120 years. So 120 years now, he's building this ark. And, you know, everybody around him are not righteous. Noah is the only one walking with God. He's the only one trying to stay in line and adjusting his lifestyle to God. Everyone else is just doing their own thing, doing what the culture does. Now imagine him building this ark and everybody out there looking at him. Now you got to know that, you know, embarrassment probably rising up in him, discomforts rising up in him, but he makes his emotions submit to what God told him to do. This is what we had to do, because this is how we have faith that pleases God. And sometimes God tells us to do something that's really uncomfortable, but we have to make how we feel submit to God. I can remember plainly years ago when God told me, I was on my lunch break, some of you heard this testimony, and God told me to go over to this gentleman's house and to pray for him and anoint him with oil. I'm not going to get into the whole testimony, but to make a long story short, I knew this gentleman because I saw him working in his yard. Anyway, make a long story short, I obeyed God. I went over, I was knocking the door. I said, listen, you don't know me, but the Lord told me to come and pray for you. And he said, come in. To make a long story short, I went in, I anointed the gentleman with oil. I prayed for the gentleman. I left. Come to find out, God confirmed what I was doing after the fact. Understanding came after obedience, because a person who went to my church at that time knew this gentleman. To make a long story short, he was dying of cancer. She knew him. He was dying of cancer. But yet, after the fact, he started gaining weight, and he was healed. Got the testimony that he was healed. Why? Because I was able to get past how I felt, fear and being embarrassed, and obey God and did what God told me to do. That's incredible. And this is what we have to do. We have to make how we feel line up with Scripture. Because when God tells us to do something, we do it in faith, and feelings have nothing to do with faith. They don't. It's like water and oil. Water and oil would never mix. You can put oil in water and they're never mixed together. Why? Because water and oil do not mix. It's the same thing with faith and feelings. They don't mix. And so when God tells you to do something, just do it. Do it. If you're afraid, do it afraid. If you're upset, do it upset. If you're worried, do it worried. No matter how you feel. Make your feelings submit to the Word of God. And then the third thing is this, because faith is a function of the Spirit, that is, we have to make sure that the natural order of things must submit to God. And let me slow that down so you don't miss what I'm saying. When it comes to faith, and because faith is a function of the Spirit, the natural order of things must submit to the Word of God. Now, what does that mean? It means that we cannot be trying to use our faith based on what we want. In other words, people say that because I want it, I'm going to use my faith to get it. God's going to give me the desires of my heart. And so because that's my desire, God's going to give me that because that's the desire of my heart. The Word says He'll give me the desires of my heart. That's what I want. And so because that's what I want, I'm going to use my faith to get it. No, no. Faith is a function of the Spirit, not of the mind. And so because faith is a function of the Spirit, it must flow with the natural order of things. In other words, the natural order of things must submit to the Word of God. What does that mean? It means that faith is not pretending that something is true when it's not true. Faith does not say it's true when it's not true. In other words, you cannot say, I'm going to marry this man because I want the man. Or I'm going to marry this woman because I want the woman. When that man or that woman is already married and belongs to somebody else. That's not faith, because you're pretending, in essence, that something's not true when it is true. Because faith now is not a manipulation tool to get you what you want. And so you can't say something's not true. I'll say something's true when it's not true, when it comes to faith, if that makes sense. So faith has to submit to the natural order of things. I've met people who are believing or were believing God to do something, and I'm thinking, faith's not going to work there, because you're calling something true when it's not true. You can't use your faith that way, because that's not faith now, that's manipulation. You're over into another area now. Then the last thing is this, as I get really close to that when it comes to faith. Because faith is a function of the Spirit and not a function of the mind, then we have to make sure that we don't allow ourselves to read the Word of God in a way that limits God in our situation. Let me see if I can put it this way. We should not read the Word of God and use the Word to limit God in our situation. Oftentimes, we read Scripture, but then we look at the Scripture and we use that same Scripture or Scriptures to limit God in our situations. Paul prayed over in Ephesians for the church, and Paul says this in Ephesians, he says, "Cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers," verse 17, "that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him." Verse 18 is the key here. He says, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. And so what this means is Paul is saying that I'm praying for your understanding to be enlightened. I'm praying for you to be able to see the unseen realm, is what Paul was saying. He is saying, I'm praying for you to see with your spiritual eyes and not with your natural eyes. And see, sometimes we can read scripture, but then we can read the scriptures in a way that limits God in our situation. We can read the word of God and we can read it in such a way that it limits the power of God. And so Paul, he prays for the church. He says, in essence, I pray for your understanding to be enlightened. The best way I know how to illustrate this is over in 2 Kings chapter 6. The prophet of God, Elijah, who was with his servant, and he was surrounded by the army, the enemy's army. And his servant said, ah, master, in essence, what are we going to do that we're surrounded by the enemy? And Elisha, he prayed. He said, Lord, open his eyes that he might see. And the Lord opened the eyes of his servant. And when the Lord opened the eyes of his servant, his servant was able to see in the spirit. And when he was able to see in the spirit, he was able to see that the angels, or the host of angels, were greater than the enemy that was surrounding them. What am I saying? I'm saying, in essence, that there is another realm that your physical eyes cannot see when it comes to faith. There's another world that your natural eyes can't pick up on when it comes to faith. And you got to understand that when you and I are operating in faith, we're operating into a whole nother level, or a whole nother realm. We're going outside of the natural and we're flowing into the supernatural when it comes to faith. So the Lord can open our eyes and open our spirits to something in the supernatural that the natural we can't pick up on. Help me, Holy Spirit. When I was in high school, I used to have a science class. And in science class, we would cut open these frogs, dissect these frogs, and what have you. And sometimes we would have a piece of glass, and they put something on the little glass. They put some water on the glass that they got from the lake or whatever, and they put a drop of water on this little piece of glass, and you take the glass and you put it on a microscope. And then you get down there and you look at that glass or that water that's on that microscope. And when you looked at that water that was on that microscope, you would see little particles moving. You see little insects, little stuff moving around in the water that you cannot detect with your natural eye. But it was there. There were live organisms, I guess is the word I'm looking for, in that water moving around that you could not see with your natural eye. What am I saying? There's another world when it comes to faith. There's another world that you cannot see with your natural eye, but you have to see with your spiritual eye. And God is saying, for those of us who will have faith in him and believe that he is who he says that he is, that he will reward us if we diligently seek him. God is saying, for those of us who dare walk with him in faith, he says, you please him. We please him when we allow ourselves to walk on another level with him. And so my prayer tonight as we study out faith is that God will bring our faith level, my faith level, and your faith level to a whole new level with him, whereby we go to the next level in our faith where we can please God on a whole new dimension, because we're pressing in closer to Him in our faith walk. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we just bless you and we honor you this evening. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to share in your word. And Father, we pray, God, that you will continue to strengthen us, you will continue to direct us, and that you will continue, Father God, to instruct us in faith, that we might go from one level of faith to that next level of faith in pleasing you. And we thank you for this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, God bless you this evening. Thank you so much for tuning in. We look forward to ministering to you Sunday morning. Amen. God bless you.
Praise God. I thank God for you out there in our viewing audience. And I know the message was a blessing to you. And I thank God for that. And I just want to get right into the scripture concerning our giving, concerning the offering. I know you want to be a blessing to this ministry. But before, I just want you to ask the Lord, what would He have you to give? Ask the Holy Spirit. He'll tell you. He'll give you a number. And I just want to read a few verses of scripture to encourage you and let you know our God count every nickel, every dime, every penny you give. And he puts his hands on it and in return will bless you for your giving. So let's just go into scriptures. We'll be in the book of Philippians, the fourth chapter of Philippians, beginning at the 14th verse. I'll be reading out of the Amplified, and it reads, "But it was right and commendable, noble and noble of you to contribute for my needs and to share my difficulties with me. And you Philippians yourself well know that in the early days of the gospel ministry when I left Macedonia, no church entered into partnership with me and opened up an account in giving and receiving except you only. But even in Thessalonica, you sent me contribution for my needs not only once, but a second time. Not that I seek or am eager for your gift, but I seek and am eager for the fruit which increased to your credit, the harvest of blessing that is accumulating to your account." I hope you're listening at that. "The harvest of blessing that accumulates to your account because of your giving. But I have your full payment and more. I have everything I need and am ample supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gift you sent me. They are the fragrance, odor of an offering and sacrifice which God is welcome and in which He delights." And he goes on to say, "And my God will liberally supply to the full your every need according to His riches in glory in Christ Jesus." Amen. And I hope that was as much a blessing to you as it was to me in reading it to you. Paul is simply sharing to the saints of Philippians, I want you to give, but I don't want you to just think it's just going into an empty hole, but it's going into an account that will accumulate on your behalf, that when the day you find yourself in need, God will have a harvest coming back to you. No, there's a scripture in Corinthians say, "He that soweth sparingly shall reap sparingly." But it also says over there in one of the New Testament Gospels about the widow who gave two mites. When you look it up in the Greek, she gave less than two pennies into the offering. And Jesus, standing up there, looked at it and said to the disciples, she gave out of her need. In other words, she needed those two pennies, but she saw the need to sow into the ministry. And when Jesus recognized your gift, not the amount, but the quality of your giving, God will make sure you get a harvest. Here, Paul telling the Philippians, God will make sure that your needs will be supplied according to what? His riches in glory. And I want to share with you, saints, God do not add nor subtract like we do. You may give a little bit, but when God give back to you, I tell you what, it's way more than you give out. It's like when you put a one kernel of corn in the ground. When that one kernel grow up, you may have a stalk that may have seven or eight different corns on them. And that each one of those corn cobs got, I don't know, I'm telling you how many little grains of corn. So you can see that when you sow into the kingdom of God, God will multiply your seed. And when it come back and you get a harvest, it's always way more than you give out. And I just want to say to you, out there in our viewing audience, this is good ground. This is good ground. Every penny, a nook of you, sent to harvest rain goes to the ministering of the gospel, which is the good news. We want to thank you for your contribution and thank you for your gift. And I just want to pray over it. Father, I thank you for those who have felt led to give. Thank you for those that the Holy Spirit has moved upon to sow of their earnings, to sow their seed into the ministry. I pray that the blessings of God that maketh us rich and add no sorrow to our life be upon each and every one that give. Your word tells us you give seed to the sower. Father, as they've sowed, I pray in the name of Jesus that they receive multiple seeds to even continually be able to sow and to continually be blessed. Meet their financial needs according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Amen and God bless you. Now I want to pray for you out there in our viewing audience. I know that during this pandemic and this time we are all put under different levels of stress. I know that emotionally things are going on, and not only financially but emotionally and mentally and even physically. We're all dealing with something. But I thank God that our God is the God who oversees the whole earth realm, and he's still alive and well on planet earth. And I just want to pray with you. Father, I thank you for all those that are in our viewing audience. And I just touch and agree with them that whatever their need may be, that you will meet that need, whether it be physically, spiritually, mentally, or emotionally. I'm going to touch and agree with them, Father, that that need will be met. If it's sickness, we bind that spirit of infirmity in the name of Jesus. And we thank you, Father, that you died on that cross and received 40 stripes, save one, for the healing of their bodies. You were wounded for our transgression, bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was upon you. And by your stripes, we were made whole. We were healed. And so we claim it right now for each and every one of our viewers. Healing virtue of Christ flowing through their bodies. We bind that spirit of oppression. We break that assignment of the enemy for making them feel like they are all by themselves. That loneliness and that feeling of despair. We come against it in Jesus' name. And we thank you that the joy of the Lord is our strength. And we pray your strength in them in Jesus' name. God bless you. And thank you for tuning in, and we look forward to seeing you next time. God bless you.